not a terrorist. She's not a threat to national security, and she has no connections to terrorism. This was admitted by the U.S. government, and it was found by the district court. The district court stated this almost 9 times in its final decision. She's an upstanding individual. She's the mother of 4 children, a PhD from Stanford, the first female lecturer at the University of Petra, Malaysia, where she currently resides. And yet, on March 2nd, 2005, she was arrested at San Francisco Airport while on her way to Malaysia through a connecting flight in Hawaii. She was arrested in front of her 14-year-old daughter, publicly humiliated at the airport.
But the district court said that was human error. It had nothing to do with racial prejudice on the basis of race or national origin or religion. It rejected that and said human error.
Well, the district,
so that's not an issue here, right?
It's not, but it signifies the importance of the district court's decision in this case, because that's the effect of people who are misidentified in a government watch list. And the record shows that it was not just government error. The government will tell you it was a mistake, but the record shows
that. The district court said human error, it's a mistake.
Right.
And the only relief it gave was on post-deprivation process. The government didn't do enough to correct its record.
The district court's own opinion, its final decision in this case, shows that the government actually knew as early as 2005 that they had no derogatory information about Ms. Ibrahim. The government also knew as early as 2006 and had decided that there was no nexus to terrorism as related to Dr. Ibrahim, and actually had requested that she be taken off the government watch list, which she had not been. So there's a lot of information that the government itself produced in this case to show that they actually had knowledge that she had no connection to terrorism, and yet for 8 years, they vigorously defended this case. The government refused to acknowledge that she was improperly placed in the government's terrorist screening database. They defended the case purely on
arguing that the courts couldn't intervene. And it was an unprecedented case, you know that. You're arguing it, but it was unprecedented. That's part of why you want all this money now.
They are
unprecedented, but they were legitimately arguing, weren't they, that it was an unprecedented case, and they didn't want the courts coming in and intervening in these no-fly decisions.
Well, the Ninth Circuit decided early on that the district courts can intervene in these decisions.
I understand.
And actually, the government had an obligation before the case was even filed, under their existing passenger identity verification process, to review their own files and determine whether she was properly placed on a list, and if she was not properly placed on a list, to remove her from that list, which they did not do. Instead, they gave her what the district court found was a vague and unresponsive response that didn't tell her anything. They should have early on, from the beginning, when she submitted her passenger identity verification form, talked to the agent who put her on the list and found out why she was placed on the list, reviewed their own records that show that they have no derogatory information about her, which they just didn't do. And for an entire year, they didn't respond to her form whatsoever until she filed this complaint.
I understand. I don't want to relitigate the case.
I understand.
Let's get to the issues here.
This is information that's evidence of bad faith, which is one of the first issues that we've raised in this case, is that the government's defense of this case was done in bad faith.
Why was it bad faith?
For a number of reasons, Your Honor. Initially, they had information to show that she had no connection to terrorism. They knew from the beginning of the case that there was no reason to put her on any of these government watch lists, yet they refused to acknowledge that and refused to take her off the government watch list.
We did get to define that this is a clear error standard, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
So we would have to say that the district court's determination on these issues about the government's mistake and that its various assertions were not bad faith, we would have to find that that was clear error.
Yes, that's correct, Your Honor.
Okay.
Yeah. And the court also looks at the totality of the circumstances.
Well, what makes the district court's determinations here clearly erroneous? It's a fairly high standard.
Correct, Your Honor. A number of things. The first thing that I was just talking about is the fact that they knew that she didn't belong in any of these government watch lists, yet continued to litigate this case and continued to defend against this case. with respect to the agent.
In any case, it's litigated.
Right,
what's the difference here?
They have to have a basis for litigating, for defending against the case.
Well, they,
that's what substantial justification is all about.
And, but bad faith takes it to a higher level. If they know that there is no basis for defending her whatsoever, she is an innocent person, which they've admitted and acknowledged. And they had an obligation before she even filed the lawsuit to investigate that and respond and clear their records, and they just refused to do it. Without explaining why, they've given no explanation for why they refused to take her off the list, even though they knew that there was no basis for having her on there. And instead, they defended the case entirely on procedural grounds. So they tried to get the case dismissed from the beginning, arguing that original jurisdiction belonged in a court of appeals.
But they were arguing that the court didn't have jurisdiction. They weren't arguing she was properly placed on the list.
No, but they could have very easily, in response to her PIVF form, before this litigation even began, take her off the list, investigate the matter, recognize that there was no basis for putting her on there, and take her off.
So what the district court identified as where the government lost, which was on post-deprivation process, you're saying that because of this post-deprivation process, so she was on the list, and they didn't do enough, as the district court found, they didn't do enough to clean their records and prevent this sort of echo chamber of bad information persisting, that makes their litigating position on standing and no equal protection or First Amendment violation, because there were a lot of claims brought mostly about pre-deprivation issues, that makes it bad faith. That's a little hard for me.
No, it's not the violation of her constitutional rights that makes it bad faith. It's their deliberateness. It's their intent. It's their knowledge from the onset.
So the government's actions of knowing that it was a mistake, which they could readily determine by looking at the form, was to check the wrong boxes, and their failure to take appropriate actions to get her off the list and prevent this echo chamber shows that the underlying action was in bad faith. Is that your position?
Well, in addition to that, Your Honor, it's also the way they litigated the case. So in addition to knowing that she was innocent but continuing to defend the case, they consistently proceeded to try and hide the truth. They refused to try to let us depose the agent, the FBI agent who placed her on the list, Agent Kevin Kelly. They made several arguments of sensitive and security information, which the district court in its own final decision found were largely not substantiated because it was old stale information.
I mean, the district court said it understood the government's position and that it was justified because of the very sensitive security nature of revealing its processes and methods, et cetera. And so why is that clear error? I mean, that... I certainly understand the frustration of being put on a list by mistake and then you're trapped in this web and you can never get out. But the issues that the government was defending, the district court found to be justified in national security issues.
If I can quote you from the district court's own opinion, its final decision in this case, which was filed January 14, 2014, and the frustration that the district court exhibits at the government's continued persistence over closing the courtroom to hide information from the general public. So the court says, in stubborn resistance to letting the public and press see the details of this case, the government had made numerous motions to dismiss on various grounds, including an overbroad complete dismissal request based on state secrets. When it could not win an outright dismissal, it tried to close the trial from public view via invocation of a statutory privilege for sensitive security information. The district court's own opinion shows that the district court had doubts about the government's own intentions, that it intended really to hide the case from public view.
But the district court upheld most of the state security,
sensitive security information.
Sensitive information. Positions and even some of its privileged ones, just on other privileged ones that your client wants. So, I mean, the district court, our general rule for this sort of issue is the district court's in the best position to make that sort of determination.
The district court actually did not uphold most of their sensitive security information privileges. We actually were able to get a lot of that in discovery under the terms of the protective order. the district court only upheld their assertions of privilege over state secrets, which had to do with very specific information. But we were able to get a lot of discovery in this case, at least enough, certainly enough discovery to win at trial and get the government to admit that she had no connection to terrorism.
A trial on only a very narrow, as the district court found, just a very narrow claim of failure to take her off and then loss on everything else.
Well, no, that's her entire case, is the failure to take her off.
But I thought the district court equal protection claims that she was put on the list, you know, the pre-deprivation, that when I went through the complaint, there was only maybe one of the many paragraphs was about post-deprivation process. Most of it was about it was discriminatory on the basis of race and religion and national origin.
No, Your Honor, we actually, the entire complaint is based on a common core of facts. It's about the placement of her name on the government watch list.
The placement?
And it's about...
But you lost on that. The only thing you won on was post-deprivation process.
We actually did not lose on the placement of her name on the government watch list. The court actually found, actually ordered the government to take her name off of the government's TSDB database and all of its sister databases that occurred as a result of that 2004 mistake.
But so
of placing her on the list.
So there's no due process violation that can stem from a mistake. And the court specifically found there was no equal protection. There was no action by the government on the basis of race.
The court actually, if I may, Your Honor, the court actually did not find that there is no equal protection or First Amendment claim. The court did not get to it.
It stated that there wasn't any racial or religious issue in the end of its order.
The court actually said that it does not get to that issue because it's not necessary, because it's already given her everything that she's requested in her complaint. And I can find that.
I'm just looking for that statement.
And it's on page 35 of the district court's decision, where it says, although plaintiff's counsel raised other constitutional challenges, those arguments, even if successful, would not lead to any greater relief than already ordered. It must be emphasized that the original cause of the adverse action was human error. While it is plausible that Dr. Ibrahim was interviewed in the first place on accounts of her roots and religion, this order does not so find, for it is not necessary to reach the point.
I have in my notes, I can't find the case. It says, error was not motivated by race, religion, or ethnicity, is what the district court, this was in the January 14th.
I'm reading directly from the January 14th decision.
That'll teach me not to put the page number in. But I'm sure the government will tell me if it exists, or I just make that up. Yeah, it says, I'm looking on page 35. It must be
35. By what number exists?
It's 462. It must be emphasized that the original cause of the adverse action was human error. That error was not motivated by race, religion, or ethnicity. That's what the district court found. I mean, that's the end of the equal protection claim.
Welcome. Thank you. My name is Joshua Walton. I'm here from the United States Department of Justice representing the Appalachian Department of Homeland Security. Just to focus back, this is a case about attorney's fees litigation. The district court reasonably and correctly concluded that plaintiff's multi-million-dollar fee request was grossly excessive for three reasons. Plaintiff's limited overall success, second, plaintiff's lack of success in unrelated claims, and third, plaintiff's inadequate record, excessive billing, block billing, and vague documentation. These factual findings, which are reviewed under abuse of discretion and clear error standards, are entitled to considerable deference, especially in light of the court's intimate familiarity with this litigation over the course of nearly a decade. and its careful review and the special master's careful review of the voluminous submissions of the plaintiffs.
I didn't understand what the district court, some of what the district court was doing when it was going through the steps in the EAJA award. In particular, the Supreme Court couldn't be clearer that the decision whether the government's position was not substantially justified is only made once at the threshold. If the government's position is substantially justified, then no fees. So once he's made the decision that it's not substantially justified, then you go on with the Hensley analysis. Here, the district court seemed to be using substantial justification on a issue-by-issue basis to say, you know, some issues are substantially justified, so you get no fees and some. I mean, that's incorrect, I think, under the Supreme Court's rulings.
I don't read the district court's opinion as quite doing that, Your Honor, although I understand why you might look at it that way. I think what the way I read the opinion is, and I think you're correct about the reading of Jean, is that the court actually quotes that section of Jean about being in a single threshold decision, but in its mind, I think it goes through analysis of saying, well, I have to look at, you know, two things. First, the underlying conduct, and then I look at the litigating positions, and there are many litigating positions, and he's sort of going through his thought process and figuring out, I think some things might have been reasonable and some things not, but at the end, I come to one conclusion, and the one conclusion he came to is that the government was not substantially justified overall, and that's why they passed over the threshold to say they're eligible for fees. And he very clearly said they were eligible for fees and, in fact, awarded almost $500,000 in fees. We're not contesting that substantial justification determination. We haven't appealed that. We've already paid the undisputed amounts.
But the problem goes beyond that because he seemed to apply that substantial justification test on a essentially issue-by-issue basis thereafter. There's still the limited success, but he didn't articulate it in quite that way. And I point you in particular to, and I struggled with this because there's overlap there, and the vocabulary makes it confusing. But let me direct you to ER 16.
Could Your Honor give me the page number on, according to the volume?
It's page 13 of the order on attorney's fees. And the first full paragraph says, this order finds that plaintiff's counsel are entitled to at least some fees and expenses under the EAJA, but substantially less than requested. And then I focus on the next sentence. Plaintiff did not prevail on all of her claims, and the government's arguments at certain stages, even on those it lost, were not so unreasonable the complete fee shifting is warranted. And that focuses on whether the government's argument is reasonable, not on the success, because it's saying even on some of the arguments that the government lost, it wasn't unreasonable, so we won't shift fees. But that seems to be applying the substantial justification test, not the limited success test. Because on arguments which the government lost, we can't say there was limited success.
I understand what your Honor is saying, and let me try to address it. I think what the district court also said is that I'm going to reduce fees for independent reason, which is that the success was so limited and it was only some relief in this case that the fee request is grossly excessive when compared to the plaintiff's limited success. That's number one. And on the very next page.
Well, and there's a grounds for applying Hensley. Well, when I look at this sentence and I look at the vocabulary used thereafter, which makes frequent reference to the government's justification or how the government's position was not unreasonable, even if it lost, and I don't see how you can reach that result under Hensley. Well, it may be that you could reach a result that says the fees have to be substantially reduced, but I can't read the existing order that
well. Let me maybe try coming at it from a different way. Let's assume that everything you say is correct, and that's what the district court was doing. The district court also went on and said, and let's assume that was erroneous. The district court also went on to say, I have other reasons why I'm reducing the fees here. Number one, and this is on page 14 of the opinion, it's 412 of the appendix, Hensley also requires
requires evaluating the extent of success in work completed at various claims when determining a fee award. And he makes this statement elsewhere in the opinion on page 410.
So what was limited about the success?
Well, first of all, he refers to it as limited throughout the opinion. And second, he says there are many things on which the plaintiff did not prevail. For example, they classified information. The plaintiffs kept trying to get that information released. That was not released. And many other unsuccessful.
What about the standing, though? I mean, so the district court did this odd thing, which makes nice sense under its view, I guess, of substantial justification, but no sense under Hensley, where it says no fees for work prior to the Ninth Circuit ruling on standing because the district court was persuaded. But then after the Ninth Circuit ruled and said no, plaintiff does have standing, then you can recover fees. I mean, obviously, plaintiff prevailed entirely on standing.
Right.
And so to bifurcate it in that way does not seem like an appropriate application of Hensley.
I think that the part about standing is different from the other claims, like the visa claim, the work relating to non-federal defendants, work in other jurisdictions, equal protection, First Amendment. There's really no argument that they prevailed against the government on any of those things. And classified information.
Well, there is an argument that they didn't prevail, but they didn't lose. The district court specifically said, as to some issues, the relief wouldn't be any different, so I don't need to reach those.
That's true with respect to equal protection, First Amendment. It's not true with respect to classified information, other things that they saw.
I think it is also true with regard to the APA claims and to the substantive due process claims. We have at least some categories where it's hard to say limited success because you didn't prevail. As the district court said, I'm punting. There's no reason to decide that because the remedy is the same.
Well, let me talk about it. There's a lot of questions here. I'm going to try to go in reverse order. Let's talk about first about why it was limited. And one of the things that plaintiff's counsel said here, which is just frankly misrepresentation of the record, is she said they were ordered removed from all government watch lists, and that's simply incorrect. If you look at page 446 of the record, the district court very clearly says, since October 2009 to the present, at that time the present was 2014, she's been included in the TSDB class of tech systems. Now, she asked to be removed from all, the district court made no suggestion that this was unlawful. It acknowledged that she was on the list, did not say there was an error, did not order this to be corrected. But plaintiff's complaint asked to be removed from all government watch lists, not just the no-fly list, but these specific lists, including the TSDB. She did not get that relief. She asked for pre- and post-deprivation relief. Now, her brief says, well, the Second Amendment complaint didn't say pre-deprivation, and that's true, but her pre-trial brief and her proposed findings of fact and conclusion of law very specifically said that the government violated due process by not giving pre-deprivation relief, and the district court didn't award that. As Your Honor pointed out, there was no finding that the error was motivated by race, religion, or anything. There were two expert witnesses in this case that were offered to prove that point. The district court didn't even quote that in its underlying opinion because there was no finding of that. And this case has always started out about it with allegations of the government targets people, including plaintiff and other people, on the basis of race, religion, and other permissible factors for the watch list. And there was no such finding. So the only thing that was the relief that was awarded here was tell her that you took her off the no-fly list. And they keep saying, we kept her on the no-fly list, we kept her on the no-fly list. That's just simply contrary to the record and the fact-finding of the district court. What the opinion says and what the record shows is she tried to fly in 2005 and she was not allowed on that one day. The government came in and said she shouldn't be on the no-fly list and she flew the next day. And the district court found that she was taken off the no-fly list in 2005 and she hasn't been on the no-fly list since then. That was the finding of the district court. And the complaint itself, going back to the original complaint, alleges that we told her that she was not on the no-fly list then. And the words of the district court is, just repeat what you already confirmed, what you already told her back in 2005, that she is not on the no-fly list and she hasn't been on the no-fly list since 2005, and correct your database. It's a very limited
relief. The government had to serve out. My note, granted, my notes, the court told the government to clean up all its databases notified the court that it had done so, and the government said, oh, we did that already, and then the district court said, well, then in that case, it won't hurt you to certify to us that you've done so.
Right, and we did certify. I think there was a few things that they traced down that they had to correct, and that was all certified on April 15th of 2014 to the district court. The district court was satisfied. We didn't appeal any portion of that judgment. And so it was our view, and more importantly, the district court's view, who had watched this litigation, the same judge, Judge Alsop, for nearly a decade. He watched this litigation from the very beginning and was involved at every stage of it. And he said, I don't find any bad faith, and I think that the relief that I awarded was very limited. And when it came to the visa, he said, the only thing I'm awarding are based on arguments that I'm coming up with myself. Not anything that the plaintiff argued, and I see that it's very limited. He kept calling the fee request grossly excessive, whopping, unfair, over and over again in his series of opinions. It's unmistakable, his tenor, that what you're asking for is just way out of proportion to what you achieved in this litigation. And to just get back to the original question about the substantial justification, even if you think what he did was error, the question is that reversible error or is that harmless error? And Blair versus Colvin from this court says that kind of error is harmless when the court has adequate independent grounds for reducing the fees in exactly the same way. Well, and that's what the district court did here.
If we know that he took out fees for standing prior to the Ninth Circuit decision, and standing is an essential element of proceeding with the case on which plaintiff had to prevail in order to get even the limited success, how can we say denial of fees of standing based on limited success can stand?
Because standing doesn't give you success in a case.
But it was the central component to getting any kind of success.
Right. And that's why he sort of split the baby, where he said, look, you got standing to proceed, but many of these things you didn't succeed on, or they weren't, and they weren't related, but some of them you did. So I'm kind of splitting the baby in a way that is similar to saying, well, I'll give you a haircut of 50% or something like that. And so I think it's a little bit unusual the way he did that, and I think it makes sense because standing gives you opportunities to then get relief, and you only got
the might to have gotten any relief, even the part that you describe as limited, without having prevailed on the standing issue.
No, Your Honor.
So how can you give her any kind of haircut for that?
Because
this was an essential component of getting the relief that she did get.
Because by the same token, she got to proceed on claims that she also did not succeed on at all. And I think that was his way of doing it. But I hear what you're saying, Your Honor, and it's a one aspect of many of the things. And I don't hear you challenging it, the reductions for any of the other claims. And I would say,
well, I got 20 minutes, you know. So
let me ask you that. On the First Amendment claim, for example, where your argument is it was not related. The district judge found First Amendment was not related, but I don't understand that whole approach.
Because the allegations there, and it's First Amendment and equal protection, were intentional discrimination targeted on the basis of religion.
But isn't it all the same factual issues?
No, it's because the factual predicate of the procedural due process question was an inadvertent human error, a mistake. The other claims were intentional and retaliatory target on the basis of religion, which this court, as Judge Ikuda pointed out, specifically said, I'm not finding that was. So I think that they're very different, both on the law and on the facts. But I do want to make one final point in my second. Hensley says very specifically, this attorney's fees litigation, which has now been going on for 2.5 years, should not turn into protracted satellite litigation, which is what it's become. What's that?
It did that.
It did. And the plaintiffs are here relitigating the facts of the thing, asking for a remand, and then presumably, if they're not happy, coming back on appeal again. I think that if your honors think that there's adequate basis on the grounds of limited relief and unrelated claims, and lack of success on unrelated claims, and those adequately and independently justify the district court's reduction here in its discretion, then you should affirm rather than sending this back for even more litigation on this issue. Thank you, Your Honors. I appreciate your time.
Thank you. I think we have some time left for rebuttal.
Thank you, Your Honors. If you look at the transcript of the hearing on the attorney's fees motion,
which is in the record, volume 7, page 1810, lines 22 to page 1811, line 2. The court says during the argument, it's not that she didn't succeed on the religious claim. I just didn't reach that, did I? It seems to me that I said it would lead to the same relief, therefore I don't have to reach it. So it's not that she failed on it, it's just that it was unnecessary to reach the religious claim. The court did not reach the rest of plaintiff's claims because they were related to her due process claim, and it was unnecessary for it to reach those claims. Also, the court in Hensley v. Eckerhart says, litigants in good faith may raise alternative legal grounds for a desired outcome, and the court's rejection of or failure to reach certain grounds is not a sufficient reason for reducing a fee. Now, the government is arguing that the court did not give us our standing fees before the second Ibrahim case because of the related claims issue, and that's actually not true. The government denied our fees on those claims because of its misapplication of the substantial justification standard. It denied our fees on the standing issue because of this, on Rahina Ibrahim's visa applications, and on what it called unnecessary discovery efforts, all of which were things that had to be done in order to prevail on her on the claims that she prevailed on. The other thing that I would like to note is the government says that it fixed the mistake. It fixed the problem. It had taken her off the list, and so there was nothing further to do, and that's actually not true. After the government filed its certificate of compliance on April 15, 2014, the government noted 30 databases in which Plaintiff Rahina Ibrahim continued to be on that it had to go in and clear from its database. The government continuously throughout the litigation claimed that it had cleared her from the database from the 2004 placement, but it actually had not, and her name was permeated throughout the government's watch list, and that was clear from the government's certificate of compliance.
Is that in the record?
That is in the record. We actually filed a motion for reconsideration of the court's attorney's fees order after the court issued, after the government filed its certificate of compliance, and that's in volume 16, and I can get you the exact page number, but
I can find it. Thank you.
All right, sure.
I have one other question.
Sure.
It bothers me to have sympathy for your position regarding the abuse of discretion you're claiming by the district court when you adamantly refuse to cooperate with the district court in the attorney fee litigation. He suggested you provide some guidance about how claims related and what hours were related and unrelated and so on, and you absolutely refused to cooperate in any way with either the district judge or with the special master, and now you want us to come in and try to do things that you wouldn't do yourself.
The court actually...
Explain that to me, how we connected with any sympathy at all.
Of course.
On what you did in the district court.
The court asked plaintiff's counsel to... The court ordered plaintiff's counsel, it's fine, to divide her fees by projects, and actually we did that. We submitted to the court multiple submissions where we went through all of our attorney's fees and divided them by specific projects, and those submissions are in the record, volumes 5 through 9. What the court wanted us to do is to cut our fee request based on the court's misapplication of the substantial justification analysis, and so we could not change our request to something that was not compliant with the law. And that was where the court had an issue, is that the court was ordering us to cut down our fee request, and we were entitled to make our fee request, and it was the court's decision, and the court was entitled to make its decision as to what was and was not reasonable.
In different areas, you would still have your appeal if you said certain hours were spent on certain projects, certain hours were spent on others, but you refused to make any estimates.
No, we did. We gave the court our hours on certain projects. We just, in terms of our fee request itself, we did not cut out our fees as the court wanted us to. And that's what the issue that the court had. In terms of the number of our fee requests, the government's counsel counsel says it's a huge number. But if you look at the number in light of what happened in this litigation, it was substantiated by our filings. It was also because the government could have avoided this from the beginning of the case by just doing what it was supposed to do and reviewing its records, and she wouldn't have had to file the lawsuit in the first place. The 8 years of litigation that she had to go through, two appeals before this circuit, multiple motions to dismiss, a motion for summary judgment, multiple discovery disputes over complicated issues about government privileges, a week-long trial, all of those things justify our attorney's fees because of the effort that she had to go through to get to where she, to win on this case. And the other thing is, if you look at it in comparison to the government's own hours and the number of lawyers that they had working on the case, we were much, much more efficient than the government was. The government had 26 lawyers working on this case and 6,800 hours more than plaintiff's counsel in this case. So, unless the court has any further questions.
Thank you. We thank both counsel for your helpful arguments. The case just argued is submitted. That concludes our calendar this morning. We're adjourned.